In the 1940s, the movie musical entered its second golden age. New York, New York, a wonderful town. So said Leonard Bernstein in his hymn to the vitality and energy of post-war America. An energy that had reinvigorated the Hollywood movie. Never before had such vibrancy, optimism, and sheer joie de vivre been seen on screen. Over the next 20 years, the movie musical produced some of the most iconic moments in all of cinema history. Gene Kelly, unforgettably, dancing and singing in the rain.
This is the original choreography for Singing in the Rain.
Oh, I love that.
Julie Andrews, lonely as a goat herd, high on a hilltop.
I used to think I looked like her when I was a kid. I sort of fell in love with her. It certainly was a high point in terms of popularity.
And it wasn't just in Hollywood where post-war optimism sang out. The musical had transformed the fortunes of film, both in India.
The big change did happen in the 50s. It was the best period for music.
And in China.
But where there's a boom, there's just as likely to be a bust. And as the 1950s motored into the 60s, people began to question whether the fanciful notion of an all-singing, all-dancing entertainment actually meant anything anymore. Would the movie musical survive into the modern world? Do you know what? It very nearly didn't. With the start of the 1940s and the world plunged into its second brutal war in decades, the future of the movie musical looked highly uncertain. What place now for the romance and joy that had defined its first golden age? Well, surprisingly, in June 1942, at the absolute height of the conflict, one of the most remarkable musicals of the 1940s opened in Berlin. Die große Liebe. The Great Love. This was a Busby Berkeley-style wartime extravaganza, aiming not simply to entertain its audience, but to indoctrinate them. On the surface, Die große Liebe appears to be an enchanting love story between Hannah, a popular cabaret singer, and Paul, a fighter pilot. And yet it carries a potent patriotic message. For this is the movie musical as wartime propaganda. The film showcased the hugely popular Swedish chanteuse Zara Leander, who had, in effect, been signed up by Joseph Goebbels to the Nazi cause. Leander quickly became one of Hitler's favourite stars. And at the finale of this box office bonanza, the curtain opens on a climactic showstopper with a deeply political twist.
Ich weiß, es wird einmal ein Wunder geschehen. I know a miracle will happen. Zara Leander's character has just had a letter from her lover saying that he expects to die on the Russian front. It's an embracing tune. And she's singing with all the love that you could possibly imagine. But that tune, listen to this. What a gorgeous piece. And as soon as you hear it, it's in your head. And everybody's singing it. It is the kind of all-embracing love song that is up there alongside Vera Lynn singing We'll Meet Again. But there's a difference here, of course. this film is Nazi propaganda. And so the miracle that she knows is going to happen may be her lover coming back to her again, but it's also, I know the miracle is that we're going to win this war. And the idea of such a great song being used to help sell the idea of losing your loved ones in a good cause is quite extraordinary.
By September 1945, the war was finally over. In America, they were looking forward to years of progress and prosperity. The following year, with the US hitting an economic boom, cinema attendances reached an all-time high. There couldn't have been a more perfect moment for song and dance to shine once more. And at the heart of this renaissance, a man celebrated as the great Svengali of the post-war movie musical, Arthur Freed.
Arthur Freed was a songwriter whose considerable achievements dated back to the earliest days of the movie musical. But by the mid-1940s, he was looking for something more from the musical form. Glorious colour, a fresh vitality, and a sophistication that mirrored the exuberant boom of post-war America.
Clang, clang, clang went the trolley.
Freed's vision is clear from the off. In the highly successful Meet Me in St. Louis, lavishly costumed set pieces taking full advantage of the developments in Technicolor film, and a star whose screen magnetism could carry an entire picture.
Thump, thump, thump went the brakes. Thump, thump, thump went my heartstrings.
Soon, Freed was heading up his own department at MGM, the legendary Freed Unit, with a powerhouse of fresh talent such as Judy Garland, Vincente Minnelli, and a young dancer from Pittsburgh named Gene Kelly. Kelly's breathless dynamism simply leapt off the screen. Not for him, the suave sophistication of 1930s Fred Astaire. Instead, a casual, regular Joe, cocky confidence that fizzed with a jiving street energy.
What's interesting is he never wanted to be a dancer. That was the last thing on his mind. What was for him was hockey and baseball. But when Gene did decide that he was going to pursue choreography, he looked around and he said, okay, how does the American male move? And there was no model for that. So he went back to his models, which were sports. You can see his style of dancing is very broad, open strokes, very wide. Gene said, I want to create something that is American. And he realized then that he could use movement to propel the story.
Stop!
Everything Gene did was about storytelling.
In his breakthrough movie, 1944's Cover Girl, Kelly demonstrated his storytelling brilliantly. Here he takes dance into the realm of pure cinema magic, using the technique of superimposition to duet with himself and show his character's inner romantic turmoil.
I said, well, why can't I do that by dancing with my alter ego? And every cameraman in the world said that's impossible to do. But I rehearsed so that every foot and every beat of music on either side, I was at a certain mark. For instance, when I jumped over myself, I had a dummy made my size, covered in black, and I jumped over the dummy. Then when it came my time to be jumped over, I did a yip, up, 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 and stopped. And my other self jumped over me. Technically, it was highly difficult, but it's never been done that way before or since.
For me, this routine shows how Kelly totally reinvented what dance could bring to the movie musical.
That was one of the problems that he faced, is that he would choreograph things, but really he was the only person who could execute those. He's often described as a perfectionist. He never understood why that had any kind of negative connotation, because he said, I simply don't understand a professional who isn't.
Perfectionist, innovator, genius. For his next bravado move, Streetwise Kelly took the movie musical quite literally onto the streets. teaming Kelly up with another superstar, Frank Sinatra, as sailors on shore leave in New York, On the Town was the first musical that rejected the artifice of the movie set for something altogether more gritty.
The studio thought the whole thing was nonsense. They said, we made all these pictures on the MGM backlot. I said, no, for this film, we have to get the feel and the smell of New York.
MGM grudgingly allowed Kelly 5 filming days in the Big Apple, but the shoot was far from easy. It rained much of the time, and crowds just visible in the top of this shot followed them everywhere.
And I said, I know how to steal the pictures, and we got a station wagon and hid the camera. We had to, because Sinatra was so well known that the kids have torn him apart. They saw the footage when we got back, and they knew that we were changing the whole look of the film musical.
But what ultimately makes On the Town so thrilling is the way the clatter of the city streets is perfectly mirrored by Leonard Bernstein's outstanding score.
The thing to remember with Bernstein's New York, New York is that it is so fast-moving because the lyrics and the music are absolutely conjoined. New York, New York, it's a wonderful town. The Bronx is up and the battery's down. The people ride in a hole in the ground. New York, New York, it's a wonderful town. Can you hear it? It's like a patter song. That's where the energy is coming from. Yup, bup, bup, dabbity, bada-dum, but very, very punchy. It's the same with the actual number On the Town. We're going on the town.
We're taking back the traces.
They nail those lyrics right onto the melody line.
We've never done it before.
All very, very fast moving. There's no sense of resting back on any of these numbers. What is that energy about? Well, think about where this film comes in American history. After years of conflict, this is the sound of America breathing out. For 24 hours, all they've got to worry about is just having fun.
Things are really humming out at the MGM studios. The big sound stages are crowded with exciting activity.
But this wasn't just fun. This was post-war cinema hitting a new high. MGM musicals were quite simply the finest movies of their day. Could they get any better? Well, yes, they could. In 1951, they began production on a masterpiece that to this day is the very epitome of movie magic. Singin' in the Rain harked back to the Hollywood of the 1920s, to the birth of the musical itself. Producer Arthur Freed had actually written its title song way back in 1929. It boasts some of the most audacious song and dance numbers ever seen on film. Perfectionist Kelly put his co-stars through long, grueling feats of sheer athleticism. And after continual takes of this complex number, Debbie Reynolds had to be carried off set because of burst blood vessels in her feet.
Gene's obsessive professionalism naturally extended to his own performance. Suffering from a 103-degree fever and hampered by a shrinking woolen suit, he pressed ahead with a scheduled sequence on a rain-swept street. A scene that looks like one continuous shot, but actually took days to shoot.
What better way to say you're in love than you kiss the girl and you wave off the cab and you whistle and proceed to splash in puddles.
I'm happy again.
And it says joy around the world. Without words, essentially, he is conveying, I'm in love, and it's all about moving the plot forward with movement.
The scene has come to transcend the film itself, endlessly captivating and regularly voted onto lists of great movie moments. You might be forgiven for thinking that this tour de force is Kelly's own favourite number in the film, but he thought otherwise.
What about the great number itself? How did that originate?
The Broadway melody number?
No, I mean singing.
Oh, singing in the rain. Oh, that old thing.
That old...
Kelly's favourite sequence, and it's not hard to see why, was in fact the highly ambitious Broadway Melody number.
The thing about the Broadway Melody Dream Ballet, which is about three quarters of the way through Singing in the Rain, is that it's completely standalone, and it's my favourite moment in the film. Partially because Gene Kelly has virtually directed, conducted, composed, choreographed the whole thing. There are two numbers in this, Broadway Melody, of course, which is the one we start with.
You got a clown on Broadway.
It's a bit flat. It's not got the kind of oomph that Gene Kelly's going to need to be able to speed us through the rest of the ballet. But then we shift to Broadway rhythm, and it's much more like this. Broadway Melody. That middle section gets taken by two brilliant arrangers, Conrad Salinger and Larry Hayton, and then reworked for that whole story that Gene Kelly had imagined. So Kelly says, I want this number of beats here. I want to be able to get up to the door and go dun dun dun. It's a triumph of the arranger's art. And when he's dancing that hot number with Sid Charisse, he makes the rhythm work to what he needs. Then when the story moves on and he's lost Sid Charisse and we go into the wonderful dream ballet within a dream ballet in which her dress becomes this incredible kind of set of wings disappearing up into the flies of the studio, then we have a whole Gershwin-esque sort of ballet piece, almost symphonic. It's as if Gene Kelly is taking us through all of the great moments of movie musical choreography until he brings us back to the last few chords of Broadway Melody.
That's the Broadway Melody.
But what's happened in that time is that we have taken two numbers and created a completely new and symphonic piece of music. If you listen to the Broadway Melody Ballet away from the film, you will be absolutely satisfied as a piece of 20th century, virtually jazz symphonic music. There's nothing else like it.
But it wasn't just in 50s Hollywood that the musical had hit a glorious peak. Almost simultaneously, musical film was flourishing in India. Though song had long been an integral part of Hindi cinema, when the country broke from the British Empire in 1947, this newly independent nation began to define itself with an exceptional run of newly independent movie musicals.
The big change did happen in the 50s in terms of the kinds of films that were produced. It was a time when you had a lot of young directors, people like Raj Kapoor, Guru Dutt. They were striving to represent an India and a cinema that would be influenced by nation building. And also, it was the best period for music.
But this could not have been a more different kind of musical from the Technicolor escapism of Gene Kelly. 1957's Piazza, an early masterpiece of Hindi cinema, is the dark, brooding tale of Vijay, an impoverished, angst-ridden poet. Directed by the visionary Guru Dutt, himself playing the central role, this was a highly personal and progressive depiction of a disillusioned society, of prostitution, the destitute, and the downtrodden. Working closely with the poet Sahir Ludhianvi, Dutt gives voice to Vijay's inner conflict in heartfelt and beautifully lyrical song.
Jinhe naaz hai Hind par wo
The poet, Sahiguru Dhyanvi, he was the son of a very rich man who had been very cruel to Sahi's mother, and all his life, this poet was looking at the terrible way women are treated and was always on the side of women. I think Guru Dutt also felt like that. It is a film which is very much about the interior angst of the poet. The song becomes his voice. So with Indian film music, it's the lyrics of the songs that really mattered.
But Piazza also showed how the Indian musical had absorbed all the techniques of the great Hollywood tradition.
He was influenced by Orson Welles, especially the light and shade, and also the Hollywood films of that era. So he's very, very cinematic. His tracking shots, when he cuts to a mid shot. Guru Dutt uses the camera very much in a kind of choreographed way. His cameraman, Murthy, said, Guru Dutt had the eye of a jeweler. He knew how to pick the diamonds.
Piazza was an instant classic of Hindi film, but it wasn't the only Indian musical to fuse beautiful music with political reality.
Mother India was a very, very important film because here you had a woman being the main story, a mother being main story. And she fights for women, preserving their honor and independence.
A hefty message for a movie musical to carry, but it does so powerfully. Left to fend for herself, Radha takes to the fields with her two sons, carrying not only a plough, but what seems the very future of the Indian nation on her shoulders.
That song, Dumi Main Hum, seems to be an affirmation of strength rather than victimhood.
It's the most important song in the film because it really tells you what the psychology of Radha, the character, is. She believes that you must accept your lot, and in poverty you have to have your own self-worth and honour.
But in Hindi cinema, equally as important as the song was the singer. Throughout Mother India, Nargis is lip-syncing to the recorded voice of the undisputed first lady of playback singing, Lata Mangeshkar. Playback singers were largely hidden away in Hollywood, but in Hindi cinema, their fame could rival that of the stars themselves.
Not every actor or actress could sing, so she was a major asset to the cinema. And Indians can accept very bad acting, but they cannot accept very bad singing. Lata Mangeshkar has so much emotion in her voice that all the top actresses, including Nargis in Mother India, would say that if Lata is singing, we have very little to do.
Magnificently combining Lata Mangeshkar's haunting vocal performance with truly epic cinematography, Mother India became an absolute icon of Indian cinema.
Not only was it a box office triumph, continuing to attract huge crowds to cinemas years after its release, it went on to become the first Hindi movie to be nominated for an Academy Award.
And the explosion in movie musicals was becoming a worldwide phenomenon, central to the booming Chinese film industry. Opened in 1961, Shaw's Movie Town was bigger than any Hollywood studio, employing 1,200 workers who beavered away to turn out a film almost every week.
Mr. Shaw, how have you managed to become the fastest filmmaker in the world?
Well, I don't call it fastest. I think the difference is the working, the labor condition. We have no unions here, you know, and we work longer hours.
Though founded on money-spinning kung fu films, Shaw's Movie Town had their sights set on matching the Hollywood movie musical bonanza. Film adaptations of popular operas had long been a staple of Chinese film, but with 1963's The Love Eterne, the music of the ancient met the modern to startling effect.
There's an old Chinese proverb, singing is better than saying. And The Love Eterne is through-sung in the style of traditional Huang Mei opera. The story is traditional too, going back thousands of years to the old Chinese legend of the butterfly lovers, the Romeo and Juliet of the Far East. And Liang, the boy she falls head over heels for, are both played by women. This too was traditional in Chinese culture at the time. There was some debate as to whether she should be made best actress or best actor. In the end, they simply invented a new category, Best Performer.
Just 2 years after Love Eterne's phenomenal success, the Chinese musical faced a very uncertain future. Chairman Mao Zedong had embarked on his cultural revolution to purge Chinese society of all things associated with the West. For a time, he'd even halted film production altogether. But away from Mao's grasp in relatively independent Hong Kong, the Shaw Studios said no, no, no to cultural censorship. Indeed, they embarked on their wildest movie musicals so far, centered around three glamorous singing and dancing sisters seeking fame and fortune, with a groovy adaptation of completely Western pop styles, such as go-go and beat music. Hong Kong Nocturne is a curious beast. At its heart, it's a fairly basic Chinese morality tale about conservative family values, but wrapped up in a completely unexpected, gaudy pop culture style. In many ways, it's a cultural revolution all of its own, albeit one that Chairman Mao could not have approved of. Shaw Studios audaciously injected the glitz of Hollywood into their movie, with hyper-stylized numbers that oozed Marilyn Monroe-style sensuality. Just listen to these lyrics. Ooh la la. But the most curious thing about Hong Kong Nocturne is how it mirrored the huge changes the movie musical was undergoing back in Hollywood, where the values of the post-war golden age were being challenged, indeed overthrown, by a younger generation. The twin revolutions of the rise of the teenager and of their music of choice, rock and roll, had a profound impact on American culture. And with traditional cinema audiences declining, the movie musical targeted this young generation as the next cash cow.
Well, Saturday night and I just got paid.
Rockers such as Bill Haley and the Comets starred in a rash of blatantly opportunistic teen musicals. Shot in black and white, with simple camera work and jiving boppers instead of glorious dancing girls, these were cheap and cheerful, low-budget affairs. It's safe to say that the likes of Hot Rod Gang were never going to rival Gene Kelly for musical posterity. But there was one exception. Bursting onto the screen in a riot of Technicolor and CinemaScope photography, directed with all the pizzazz and panache of a classic Hollywood movie musical, 20th Century Fox's The Girl Can't Help It was a true game changer.
Saturday morning,
This was a youth musical that appealed not just to rock and rollers, but to movie buffs. French critic and auteur Jean-Luc Godard said of it, "It is a fountain of youth from which cinema has drawn fresh inspiration." The Girl Can't Help It doesn't have much of a plot, a fable about the world of celebrity, but boy are its musical numbers inspirational. This was the first time the raw energy of performers like Little Richard had been captured with such cinematic flair.
The Girl Can't Help It, I think, just blew every 14-year-old away. There was Fats Domino and Eddie Cochran. As English kids, you just had to see them. It was America. Living in Newcastle 10 years after the war, still at school, and I desperately wanted to be part of it. Sounds ridiculous, doesn't it, now? We don't want to do history and geography. We want to be this. I mean, no chance, but that's what we wanted to be.
But if any rock star was going to resurrect the fortunes of the movie musical, it surely had to be the King. You don't like crazy music, don't like rocking bands. Elvis Presley's hip-swinging sexual charisma was enough to carry even the flimsiest of movies. Baby, I don't care. Though his very best, Jailhouse Rock, was a classic of the genre.
Jailhouse Rock. Elvis was magnetic, dynamic. He looked like no one else looked.
What made Jailhouse Rock so significant was that MGM saw it as the natural progression of its classic movie musical formula. Choreographer Alex Romero was brought in to give the title number all the verve and sophistication of an old-time Hollywood showstopper. At the very moment where Fred Astaire and Gene Kelly were making their last major appearances, Elvis gave the movie musical a rocking breath of fresh air.
Sensational. We all copied it. Every performer wanted to be like Elvis.
Within a year of Jailhouse Rock's release, the young Bruce Welch's dream had come true. As guitarist with the Shadows, he found himself at the heart of the rock movie revolution.
Thank you very much. Now we'd like to introduce to you our vocalist, Cliff Richard.
We started the first tour with Cliff in October 1958. And by February of 59, Cliff became the British Elvis.
The young ones, darling, we're the young ones.
And just like the King before him, Cliff stormed the big screen.
Should we dream together?
In what became a breakthrough in British musical film. 1961's The Young Ones was an instant hit, a distinctly homegrown affair that was like a sunny seaside postcard set to a crooning romantic soundtrack. What's not to love?
Teach the young ones of our own.
The Shadows were on tour when news reached them that a follow-up movie was needed, and fast.
Brian Bennett, the drummer, and I were in the theatre early, and we got a synopsis of the idea for the next film. And I said, look, this is the next movie's going to be about all going on a summer holiday. So I had my guitar, and Brian was in the pit because he plays keyboard. And I literally went, we're all going on a summer holiday. Da, 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 da. And Brian in the pit, and he went, we're going where the sun shines brightly.
We're going where the sea is blue. We've seen it in the movies. Now let's see if it's true.
Cliff and the Shadows play bus mechanics, escaping grey, miserable London for the sunny climes of the continent. The effervescent appeal of its title song and buddy movie charm catapulted it to box office smash.
For me and you.
We filmed it in Yugoslavia, France, and finished up in Greece. And we were in the last shot of the film.
We're all going on a summer holiday.
We finished the movie, and 6 or 7 weeks later, they said, the movie's a bit short, and the easiest thing to do is just to slot another three chord merchant in. And Cliff and I had written Bachelor Boy.
He said, son, you are a bachelor boy, and that's the way to stay.
They hired Elstree Studios and built a mock-up of us on the road in the bus. That was another million seller from the movie.
Happy to be a bachelor boy.
Summer Holiday's astounding success was no fluke. It captured all the oomph and optimism of 1960s Britain. And by making pop stars into film stars, it totally transformed the fortunes of our native movie musical.
But then, just when you thought you'd seen the only romantic musical featuring a garage mechanic, along comes another one. But this one could not be more different. Taking the cadences of everyday chit-chat and marrying them to a lushly orchestrated score.
C'est terminé. Oui. Le moteur cliquette encore un peu à froid, mais c'est normal.
In the mid-1960s, French cinema had been rejuvenated by the Nouvelle Vague, the New Wave, a group of radical and fiercely intellectual filmmakers. Much as they were enthralled to the great movies of Hollywood, nobody expected them to dive into the world of the musical.
My father, Jacques Demy, dreamed about doing musicals, and then he wrote The Umbrellas of Cherbourg, Les Parapluies de Cherbourg, and he wrote it like an opera. It's not even a musical. It's a statement much more radical. They don't speak at all. They don't dance. They just sing.
Mon amour, oh mon amour.
Geneviève, ma petite Geneviève.
Qui je t'aime.
Set during France's turbulent war with Algeria, The Umbrellas of Cherbourg is visually alluring, sentimental, tragic. Two lovers torn apart when he's called up for battle. Demy knew exactly what he wanted to achieve with this magnum opus. To keep tugging at our heartstrings.
Pourquoi ne suis-je pas mort?
And he does so, over and over again, with this one simple melody that runs throughout the film like an operatic recitative.
An incredibly keening, sad number to make the central number for the whole film. It's there at the beginning, it's there at the end, it's referenced throughout. But then I think this is a very French take on what life and indeed the movie musical is.
Mais je ne pourrai jamais vivre sans toi.
This isn't a Gene Kelly happy ending film. This is a film that's bittersweet. And you can even hear it in the chord sequence. This is minor. To major, back to minor. But of course, what helps this build of passion and our tears to flow with this song is the fact that every time that tune comes back, it goes up a semitone.
Deux ans, deux ans.
Ne pleure pas, je t'en supplie.
Jacques Demy and Michel Legrand were romantic guys. And when they were working on the music, Jacques said to Michel, when you compose the big theme of the film, when he's going to the war, we should cry right away. We should need a Kleenex and swipe.
So they created something that gets you in your stomach.
Viens, mon amour, mon amour.
But remember, this is the experimental spirit of the French New Wave. Demy's film catches us emotionally off guard. Separated by war, the lovers drift apart and marry others. By chance, they meet once more in the final scene. And again, their theme tune is reprised and swells as their final parting approaches. The question persists. Is this the happiest sad ending in movie musicals? Or the saddest happy ending? Just listen to that tune. The beauty and profundity of Demy's vision is that it's both. Umbrellas of Cherbourg proved that there was still a rich seam of invention for the movie musical to explore, at least in the world of European art film. But mid-60s Hollywood was never going to go down that path. Major studios were taking no risks, relying on bankable adaptations of proven hit stage shows, such as The Music Man or My Fair Lady. Then in 1965, along came a Hollywood movie musical that, in its truly cinematic ambition, would completely eclipse its stage origins and give the genre its biggest hit to date.
It starts in silence, just bird song. And then little sounds, little musical sounds start to come in, and as you get closer and closer and closer, it's the anticipation, the beauty of it, the daring of it. And then suddenly, in the distance, there's this little figure on a hill. And you home in, and there she is. It's the best beginning to a movie ever, isn't it?
Director Robert Wise was a master of this kind of big panoramic screen musical, having transformed West Side Story into cinema magic 4 years earlier. But his trump card with this film was his leading lady. Julie Andrews had just completed Mary Poppins, but it hadn't been released yet. Director Wise had his sights on her and persuaded the Disney studios to let him see a rough cut. As soon as he saw her on screen, he exclaimed, "Let's go sign this girl before someone else grabs her."
I sort of fell in love with her. I used to think I looked like her when I was a kid. I used to have the LP of the Sound of Music. Actually, the picture on the back of Julie Andrews, I used to kiss before I went to bed. That's how obsessed I was, I'm afraid. For me, it's not really a dance movie, but you feel as though you're watching a dance movie, because the camera really takes you places and you travel with them. The Do-Re-Mi number is very, very simple choreography for the children. It takes you all over Salzburg in such a thrilling way. It's a great example of the camera being able to give you that same exhilaration you get from dance.
Helping the Sound of Music's transformation from stage to screen were new songs written by the original composer, Richard Rodgers. Most significantly, I Have Confidence, a number which I think shows just how effortlessly Julie Andrews inhabits the playful spirit of the character of Maria.
I have confidence they'll put me to the test, but I'll make them see.
It almost couldn't happen on stage, because it is a moving number. It's getting Julie Andrews from the convent to the workplace where Christopher Plummer is waiting for her.
I have confidence the world can all be mine.
It's quite fast moving. It's like a sort of brass band. And as she starts normally, but then it builds up. Every time we hear it again, it's gone up another semitone.
I have confidence that spring will come again. Besides which, you see, I have confidence in me.
And as it goes higher and higher, she gets more and more outrageous. She's swinging around, she's got the guitar, she's got the bag. She gets up to the gate.
I have confidence in confidence alone.
And she's presented with this huge house. It breaks the number. And she looks through and just says,
oh, help.
And we know that everything we've seen up until now has been manufactured. Her confidence hangs by a thread. And she has to pull her boots bag up again and she has to go back into the number. And it does it really quietly. Beautifully done.
I have confidence in confidence alone.
And then when she gets her confidence back again, we're with Julie Andrews as she sings her highest note and runs charging through that enormous courtyard.
Besides which, you see, I have confidence in me.
And the music finishes bang, just as her finger goes for the bell.
Oh.
It is a purely cinematic movie musical moment, which couldn't really work on stage. Scooping 5 Oscars, The Sound of Music became the highest-grossing film of all time. A distinction it held for years afterwards. And its delightful lure has never waned. Indeed, it's only grown. It's getting to be something of a sing-along habit with a younger generation. But had the movie musical climbed its highest mountain with the triumph of The Sound of Music? As the 1960s progressed, the big-budget, family-oriented musical looked like it was on the road to nowhere. The post-war American dream was fading. The summer of love was far from the cheek-to-cheek romance of the classic movie musical. Civil rights protesters had taken to the streets. America was at war with Vietnam. And in the midst of all this, Hollywood put its blinkers on.
I've never lost in battle or game. I'm
and fiddled while America burned, offering up hearty singing knights in shining armor.
One blow and all of
Richard Attenborough dancing with a two-headed llama.
And when we part, there'll be no
soothing
tears,
a troubled nation no with Rex Harrison serenading, yep, a seal.
Into your eyes.
And an uncharacteristically sensitive Clint Eastwood talking to the trees.
But suddenly my words reach someone else's ear. Touch someone else's heartstrings too.
These extravagant productions, overblown, overhyped, and wildly over budget, were totally out of step with the tumultuous mood of late 60s America. The summer of love that ushered in the long-haired bikers of Easy Rider and the sexual ambiguities of Midnight Cowboy. The dapper charm and sweet innocence of Gene Kelly and Julie Andrews truly were a world away. And so, in this climate, how do you solve a problem like the movie musical? The answer lay in the visionary talents of a choreographer turned filmmaker who single-handedly revitalized the genre, Bob Fosse. He'd worked in the classic era of 1950s movie musicals, but Fosse wanted something more, something transcendent. And so, as the genre seemed to be heading towards a slow and very expensive demise, Fosse was given his break to become an auteur.
Flip your wings and fly to daddy. Flip
your and what a start.
Flip your wings and fly to daddy.
With a flourish of hip that couldn't be more hippie-era America, his directorial debut, Sweet Charity, said Fosse knew exactly how to make the movie musical swing.
Hit the floor and crawl to daddy. Hit the floor and crawl to daddy. Hit the floor and crawl to daddy.
Fosse kind of changed it all. He started to look at dance on film a different way.
Flip your wings, fly.
Flip your wings, fly.
He really took dance and camera and put it together where it was not about the head-to-toe shot. It was about a shoulder or like a snap. And that informed the dance and the story just as much as a tap dance that was full body, head-to-toe.
Small gestures were a Fosse trademark. But they required huge skill and precision.
Boo down, boo down, slap.
So influential was Fosse's style that dancers still strive to master his technique. Here in New York today, they're rehearsing Sweet Charity's standout number, The Rich Man's Frug.
You're going to turn around and you're going to flip straight up stick.
You worked with Fosse. What was he like?
He was really passionate about his dancers and they better work. Or, you know, he definitely would let a dancer go. And he was a taskmaster for sure. He expected everyone to work to their fullest capacity.
In this rare rehearsal footage, here's Fosse himself directing his distinctive moves and also explaining how he took dance from stage to screen.
Good or bad, stage direction has certain conventions, certain restrictions. In film, however, the only limitations that I've discovered are the limitations in the director's head.
Rich Man's Frug was a showstopper on an unprecedented scale. For what was labelled its big finish, Fosse ordered exotic sets, had not one but eight cameras shooting simultaneously, and brought a crazed psychedelic palette to the movie musical. Far out. Perhaps too far out. Although critics went wild for Sweet Charity's bravado, the public thought otherwise. Box office takings were less than a fifth of its extravagant $20 million budget. Fosse may have been down, but he was certainly not out. And in 1972, Cabaret was his passport to success.
It was a story that incorporated corruption, sexual ambiguity, false dreams, and Nazism.
With its dazzlingly staged numbers set in the seedy Kit Kat Club in 1930s Berlin, Cabaret exuded a decadence that was the perfect vehicle for Fosse's drive to embrace the extreme. And with her ballsy, high-kicking performance as Sally Bowles, it made Liza Minnelli a bona fide screen sensation. It also led to the film having the distinction of becoming the first ever X-rated movie musical.
The film lulls us in with a false sense of security.
Welcome and bienvenue. Welcome.
Kander and Ebb's great opening number, which joins up German cabaret leader, very much in the style of Kurt Weill, with the great American songbook, and of course delivered faultlessly by Joel Grey.
Willkommen, bienvenue, welcome.
Im Cabaret, au Cabaret, au Cabaret. Leave your troubles outside.
Life is a cabaret, or is it? For in this movie, unlike any American movie musical before it, you don't really know what's going to happen next, and that is its power.
Stag in the forest runs free.
Though almost all of Cabaret's great numbers are confined to the nightclub stage, there's one staggering exception. In a beer garden, a young boy singing beautifully, "Tomorrow Belongs to Me." and then the shock. The camera pans down to reveal his Hitler Youth uniform. One by one, everyone in the garden starts to join in. Totalitarianism is visibly on the rise. No matter how many of Liza Minnelli's great song and dance numbers are yet to come, this is the moment where the movie musical finally shed any veneer of escapism. The phenomenal success of Cabaret ensured that, as far as movie musicals were concerned, Tomorrow definitely did belong to Bob Fosse.
Best director in Cabaret.
At the 1973 Academy Awards, the film garnered 8 Oscars, more than any musical had ever won before.
And Liza Minnelli for the best actress in Cabaret.
Fosse had revitalized the genre, which begs the question, was there anywhere darker the movie musical could possibly go? For Fosse, of course there was. How about a steamy, seductive, polysexual dance routine, more taboo-busting than any movie musical before, and indeed since? Itself an Oscar winner, All That Jazz turned out to be Bob Fosse's last hurrah in the world of musical film. But by pushing the boundaries of song and dance, it paved the way for this fading genre to reinvent itself once again. Next time, the movie musical really rocks out, takes to the streets, and creates a whole new style of blockbuster, Bollywood.